Well, the Army and the Navy have a new unmanned aerial vehicle, a large drone with immense capability in terms of being able to operate over large areas for upwards of 30 hours. And the reconnaissance and the data that the Drishti10 Starliner drone can actually provide is something which can enable our forces to take a look at large areas over a period of time. So what exactly are we talking about? What is the Drishti10 Starliner? Well, the Adani Defense and Aerospace manufactured Drishti10 is a medium altitude, long endurance, unmanned aerial vehicle. It can operate non-stop for up to 36 hours to guarantee persistent coverage of large areas under surveillance. The Drishti10 can, for example, be used to cover shipping activities in the Indian Ocean and monitor for pirate and terrorist attacks. It has state-of-the-art sensors which can track movement on the ground and sea by day and night and in any weather condition. Data from the Drishti is transmitted to a ground station, ships or other reconnaissance aircraft through a secure data link. It's designed to undertake intelligence, surveillance and reconnaissance operations across the Indian Ocean region. The Indian Army and the Navy are acquiring two Drishti10 UAVs or drones each. And that's possibly for starters. It's built by Adani Defense and Aerospace as an indigenously built variant of the Hermes 900 UAV of Elbit Systems of Israel. It presently has over 70% indigenous content.
The drone attacks and the physical attacks, what is the kind of proportions that we are talking about in terms of numbers? And a drone, the UAV that you have flagged off today, what kind of a role is it going to play in countering it?
So the I just said that there were two types of operations that are happening. One is the anti-piracy operation. So anti-piracy operations have now largely, we have only had two incidents of late. One was both were not Indian flagged vessels, but in the second case we had Indian crew, so we could respond because we got the necessary concurrence from the owners of the vessel, and we boarded and rescued the crew. So we are now very proactively deploying our units there to ensure that the pirates keep away. So that is one part of it. The other one is of course the anti-piracy, anti-drone operations. The drones attacks are largely happening in the Red Sea, and some are happening in the North Arabian Sea and in the Central Arabian Sea. The total numbers, if you look at in the last about 40-42 days, about 35 attacks have happened. Largely on Israeli owned or Israeli flagged or Israeli related shipping. No Indian flagged vessel has been attacked so far. So that is the status.
You spoke about, the last 20 years you've been using drones, but now this thing about Atmanirbharta, how critical is it for the Indian Navy and the Army?
It is absolutely critical, ma'am. We have given a commitment to our national leadership that by 2047 we'll be Atmanirbhar Navy. As of now, you'll be aware that out of 66 ships and submarines under construction, 64 are being built in India. And we are looking at, our deck-based fighter aircraft being built in India, helicopters being built in India, missile systems being built in India, weapons, sensors, everything will be built in India.
A significant milestone for India, India's Navy, as well as Adani Enterprises, as this first privately manufactured unmanned aerial vehicle, Drishti10, is being flagged off today by the Chief of Naval Staff. I have with me Jeet Adani, Vice President of Adani Enterprises. Many congratulations on this momentous occasion. What is the kind of numbers that you're going to be delivering? And I understand that within record time of 10 months, your company managed to give this to the Indian Navy.
Absolutely. Thank you. It's a very proud moment for us. So right now what we're talking about is two drones going to the Navy and two going to the Army. There's a larger contract that we're also participating in that's not closed yet. That's for about 97 of these drones being supplied to the Navy.
This has also been exported, I understand, what you're manufacturing here.
Yes, absolutely. So before we, as we are ramping up the facility, we first started out with exports. So we've exported about 20 of these primarily to Israel.
So what we must understand is not just about Atmanirbharta, self-reliance, but you're also positioning India in that sense in the world space as a global leader with these technologies.
No, absolutely. I think that's a testament to both our and our partners' ability to design and create a system which has been world standard and is recognized as such by everyone.
Adani Enterprises is having a range of businesses, and if you talk about airports, you're also planning to do it outside of the country. Tell us more about those plans.
So right now, there's nothing that I can confirm that we're doing outside, but there's obviously a lot of opportunities that we're exploring around Asia and Africa and Europe.
Okay. A lot of interest in Navi Mumbai as well. Share with us what you can about the plans there.
So Navi Mumbai obviously is going to be another jewel in the crown for us. We are starting off in the first phase with a capacity of 20 million passengers, which is going to start by December of this year. And the ultimate capacity that we want to ramp up to is 90 million passengers out of that airport, with two runways, three terminals, access from metro, buses, and high-speed roads, and all of across, and also connecting high-speed rail. When we look at that, we talk about Mumbai and Navi Mumbai together. That system alone will be about 140 to 150 million passengers total, which will make it one of the largest in the world of its kind. A little bit more about Navi Mumbai in terms of design and aesthetic. What we've tried to do is take a step forward in terms of what people imagine airports to be, rather than being, sort of these station or very physical hard structures. We've tried to get in a lot of technology, which at the end of the day eases the passengers' flow and increases their convenience and gives them that peace of mind that, when they're at the airport, they're not, running around in chaos, and they have all the information that they need right at their fingertips.
I'm looking forward to that. That sounds like a world-class structure. Thank you so much. That's the Adani's Enterprises Vice President, Mr. Jeet Adani, talking about the plans for Navi Mumbai and also speaking about how the enterprise itself is making India not just self-reliant, but also making it a global leader in these technologies. So it's a very important, momentous and exciting day for India. This first privately manufactured UAV being flagged off by the Naval Chief. I have with me Ashish Rajwanshi, CEO of Adani Aerospace. Very exciting, and when you see something like this, it sounds like the high-tech thing of India and indigenously manufactured, 70% indigenous. How much is this going to help the Indian Navy in terms of the kind of recent threats we have seen over the seas?
See, we need to appreciate how the doctrine is changing from manned to unmanned. A couple of years back, we were the first one in the country to talk about unmanned is going to be the future and manned will become passe. In 2019, when we set up this facility, there were many naysayers who thought, this is something which is not going to happen. And they were not able to appreciate how this has become the mainstay when you look at the geopolitical conflict happening in Eastern Europe or in the Middle East in terms of intelligence, surveillance and reconnaissance. Today, we have the foot soldier in India who is actually doing ISR. But unless we complement the foot soldiers with technology in terms of either unmanned systems, in terms of satellite and cyber, we will never do our missions in full. What we have set up is a full line from structures, avionics, electronics, payloads within the country with more than 70% indigenization. And this is the first bird which is going to my Indian customer, Indian Navy. Very proud moment for us. It's a flagship, it's a watershed moment for India. It's a dream come true for our chairman, Mr. Gautam Adani, who always talks about the vision of how do we support and play a humble role in India growth story and supporting the Indian Armed Forces.
70% indigenization is very impressive. Does this mean that you have many more enterprises that you're actually supporting to integrate it finally into this firm?
Absolutely. The very philosophy of Adani is not about doing everything on its own. It's important how do we support the wider ecosystem of MSMEs, startups and others who can actually work with us. When we kickstarted our business many years back, what we realized was that the technology, talent and the passion is actually existing. What they were not able to find is a big platform which can actually support them. Today, I have more than 75 suppliers and tier one partners who are working across our businesses. We have invested more than 1,500 crores just in the growth of these MSMEs, giving them a platform and giving them work so that they can go from point A to point B.
Walk us through the features of this particular UAV.
This is one of the most advanced ISR UAV in the global market.
Wow.
Three or four things which are very important to appreciate. It's an all-weather UAV. Some of our missions, what we do in north, are in extreme temperature. So it has a de-icing feature built into this. Some of the missions which we are doing in Indian Ocean, range becomes important. This is the first SATCOM-enabled indigenous UAV. And SATCOM means that the range is no longer an issue. you want to do a 1,000 kilometers mission or you want to do a 4,000 kilometers mission, it's possible. Number three, in terms of the payload, it has some of the most advanced payload which are not tied to the OEM technology. So tomorrow, if a company in India is creating its own payload on electro-optics, on Comet or ELINT, we can actually integrate those in this bird. Number fourth, this is the first bird in the global market which doesn't need any segregation of airspace. So what we call STANAG certification, it can fly both in segregated and unsegregated space because the traditional UAVs which are in the military domain require special permissions in the civil domain.